What do you need nowadays to build a high quality and great sounding home studio? In this video, we'll go through the basics, starting from scratch. We'll touch on gear, and we'll take a look at acoustical principles to make sure you get the most out of your space. Let's get started. In a typical home studio setup, there's a computer, sound card, monitors, headphones, USB controller, microphone, and instruments, depending on what you're doing. When budgeting your home studio build, it's good to keep in mind that gear is an important part, but it's only a piece of the puzzle. When you listen, the sound you hear is a combination of direct sound from the monitors and reflected sound from the room. The direct sound from your monitors is truthful and pure, but when the sound travels back as a reflection, you begin to hear colorations in it. Nowadays, there are various options available for tackling the sound reflections, from sound absorbers to diffusers. Decent monitor positioning alone can make an enormous difference to the performance of your studio. So no matter how much budget you reserve for the gear, you can easily make things better or worse if not considering certain principles. Finding an ideal spot for your home studio can be tricky, as homes aren't typically designed with recording purposes in mind. A thing to look out for when choosing a room is its shape. If possible, square rooms should be avoided because they're acoustically very difficult to treat. And in a perfect world, you wouldn't even have parallel walls. The room we're using for this video is a perfectly imperfect example of a room that really could work as a home studio. It's a spare bedroom that we've cleared of furniture to serve the purpose. It's rectangular, though not very big, around 12 square meters or 130 square feet. The material of the walls also plays a part in the room's acoustics. Concrete, for example, is a very solid material, so it doesn't let the sound pass through easily. Instead, it reflects most of the sound. That means that wall loading or reflected sound is going to be a much more significant issue than if all the walls were made of plasterboard or wood. The most noticeable effect of this will be excessively loud and boomy bass. Let's talk about why the bass level often gets too high in a room. Below certain frequencies, as the wavelengths get longer, the monitor can't control the direction of the sound it's radiating. The bass sound is said to be omnidirectional, meaning that low frequencies travel not only to your listening position, but in every direction. You'll notice this if you listen to the monitor from behind. You can easily hear the low frequencies, but not the higher ones. So when the low frequencies hit a hard reflective wall behind the monitor, they bounce back to your listening spot, and you hear a wide bass boost. Note that this happens with all loudspeakers. It's a fact of physics. Ideally, your home studio room should be symmetrical around the listening position. But in this case, we need to face the facts and do the best we can with its imperfect shape. There's plenty we can do to make the most of it. If you don't have the monitors yet, this is the perfect moment to consider what are the features you need, how loud you want to listen, and at what distance. Our website includes plenty of information that'll help you pick the perfect system for you. It's especially worth learning about the advanced room adaptation that Genelec SAM Smart Active Monitors offer. The SAM technology allows the monitors to be controlled with a computer through our GLM, Genelec Loudspeaker Manager, software. With the measurement microphone that comes with the GLM kit, you can easily calibrate the monitors to suit the conditions in your room. In this case, it's clear that our room is acoustically challenging, and that's why we'll be going for a Smart Active Monitoring system. On top of everything, GLM can provide a grade report, that's Genelec Room Acoustic Data Evaluation, which tells you in more detail what is happening in your room sound-wise. The grade report is delivered separately as a PDF file to your email, and it only requires a free and easy-to-make Genelec Cloud Services account to use. In this case, we're using the Genelec 8030 system model, 8330. The subwoofer we're using for this room is a 7350. Both the monitors and the subwoofer are SAM models. Using this technology, it's simple to find out more about what's happening in the room and to calibrate the monitors in the best possible way. This feature is called AutoCal. It's an automatic process that listens to your monitors precisely and adjusts each one to suit its position within the room and the overall monitoring system. Finally, for anyone that likes a little color added to the system, GLM offers manual tweaking options. Before doing anything else, let's place the monitors where they would ideally be located. It's good to be close to the back wall to avoid back wall cancellation. That happens when an opposite phase reflection from the back wall reaches the listening position, cancelling out the direct sound from the monitor and resulting in unwanted frequency response dips. So, being close to the wall avoids that narrow cancellation dip, but boosts the overall bass level instead. That's fine though. It's just a wideband boost and we can easily reduce the amount of low frequency energy. So let's place the monitors on the table and the subwoofer on the floor, not right in the middle, but slightly more to the left or the right side for a more even response. The placement on the floor, beside a wall, increases the acoustical loading from the wall and floor and improves the sound output. For typical two-way systems, the recommended height of the monitor's acoustical axis is at ear level. And the distance between the left monitor and the right monitor should equal the distance between each monitor and your head. This forms an equilateral triangle. We'll place the measuring microphone at the listening spot and open up GLM. Just define your system layout and room measurements and you're ready to go. Right, the results are in. Let's see what GLM will show us. So first of all, the left speaker. So what we've got here is in red, we've got the measured curve. Blue are the filters that GLM's autocal has applied to that red curve, resulting in the green curve, which is what we hear at the listening position. And as expected, there's a wide band increase in level at lower frequencies. So that's probably because the wall is close by. This quite severe dip here is, of course, not an issue because it will be covered by the subwoofer, hopefully. Here in the lower mid, we've got some coloration which is likely to be caused by reflections from the desk. Let's take a look at the right speaker. Broadly similar. Overall, you can really see that the green curve that's resulted from the autocal actually results in a very listenable situation. Take a quick look at the subwoofer. 85 hertz where we want to cross over. Plenty of energy, so that's a great place to cross over. And the subwoofer's also very well covering the frequency range where we had the dip. We might as well just go straight back in and see what we can do with this area by simply raising the loudspeakers by using a pile of books as speaker stands. Okay, so let's see what happened. Yes! That's a textbook result. So here in the upper bass, lower mid-range region, the frequency response is really cleaned up nicely. Check the other side just to make sure. Same thing. Not quite so good, but we are in a non-symmetrical room, so that's to be expected. Now, when I ran the AutoCal last time, I also ordered the grade report. And because I happen to work for Genelec, I know an expert acoustician. So I'm going to go find Yossi and ask him if he'll talk us through it. Thanks for coming. You probably heard we're building a home studio and this is it, or this will be it.
I have heard and it sounds really interesting.
Take a seat. And, rather than me telling you about this, maybe you can tell me a little bit about this grade report.
Of course.
What it tells us about the room, where we're at and how we can make things better.
Well, looking at your traffic lights now that it's on the screen, can see that there's already a fair amount of green there, which is good. So the frequency response is, it seems that it's pretty nice already. But what you can of course expect is that there's a problem with the echoes. So yeah, the reverberation is too high. We could actually go through the report a bit and see how it shows up. Well, this is already one good screen that you can see that when you measure the speakers, you record the sound. And then when the sound is stopped now, the system calculates that how long time does it take the sound to attenuate,
right?
60 decibels. And then it plots that at each frequency. And that is your reverberation time, the T60. And that is really a good way to look at the room. Actually, if you look at just the shape of the reverberation, it's not so bad, but you can see that at this area here in the mid-band, or actually quite frequency range, it's really high. So you have quite long echo in this room. But at the high frequencies, you usually don't have a lot of, I mean, that is already quite nicely attenuated, even in this kind of empty room. And you can see that at higher frequencies, you have quite low value of the echo or the reverberation. So that gives you an idea that your whole reverberation time graph is elevated. So there's this echo at wide frequency range. I mean, when you did the grade, you put the dimensions of the room in the grade or in the GLM, and that was inputted in the grade report. So it calculates for this bass the expected noise value for the reverberation time. And you can see it from here that you are really like a lot higher than you should be in this kind of
four
space.
Times higher.
I mean, this you can argue whether you want to be in this damped space. Maybe it's too low even with that 0.2 milliseconds. But you can probably be somewhere about 0.4, and that's still quite nice. It's not too dead. And that's what I would really start to address right. in the acoustic treatment of this space.
So can you help me write a shopping list or some kind of guideline for where to go?
Sure, yeah, that would be good.
And then please come back and have a listen when it's done.
Of course I will. Now after a few days of thinking, I have some rough plan of the acoustics ready. The requirement for the acoustics is that it's good enough for doing home recordings, recording guitars, doing voiceovers, things like this. We can't really make massive constructions in this case, which is fine. We want to save the floor space and some empty space for the walls as well. So we did already measure the speakers in an empty room, which is a good starting point. We got the grade report, so we have an understanding of the room. That's a good thing. We also have already selected the listening location. That's of course coming from the practical use of the room, but also from the acoustics point of view. And if preferable, always in front of the center point of the room. That's where you get usually the best out of both worlds, that you have a nice area with not much effects from the room modes, negative effects, plus the room is not really influencing the sound so much. The grand plan in this case is that we try to absorb the surfaces so that there's no opposite walls or opposite surfaces without treatment. So that's the starting point, to try to put the absorptive material in a clever places in the room, and also use the ceiling, because in the acoustics or doing the acoustics of the room, you have to think about area. So how much of the free or untreated area can you cover is always more effective. Curtains are of course in the room as well. We thought about those. Quite heavy curtains are good, so they absorb the sound nicely. The walls behind the loudspeaker, that's always good to treat. You get the early reflections attenuated nicely and you get better stereo image. The wall behind the listener, important, because that's where you get the reflection from the loudspeakers directly. Darren wants to spend time in the room. It's not just acoustic treatment on the wall, on the ceiling, but also carpets on the floor. They help a lot. Sofa. It's a really not very big, fairly small room, so this kind of a big furniture will also be quite effective. When we think about the modules or the absorptive materials on the walls, it's always good to choose the location carefully, wisely, and then when you have done that, try to maximize the thickness of the modules, because the thinner you make the panels, the more you attenuate only high frequencies, and you really don't attenuate all the other frequencies. So you're gonna tilt the frequency balance and also the reverberation time. That's not gonna sound nice.
Right, so with the help of my friend, I've got the panels up. On the front and the back wall, we've got them separated from the wall ever so slightly. And on the ceiling, a bit of a bigger distance between the panel and the ceiling. It already sounds better. There's definitely less of a high frequency echo now. I've also got panels on the side wall, but this wall is still a bit of a problem. We've still got the windows and a concrete wall. But what will really help there is a nice thick curtain. So I ordered the curtains a bit wider than we need for the window, just so that they can hang loosely in these nice folds. So that brings the curtain a little bit away from the window and away from the concrete wall, more into the room, so it's more effective at absorbing. So that's another step forward, which is really, really great. Now, the only untreated surface in the room is the floor. So, it's carpet time. Right, so I've brought the table back in, or in fact what I've done is I've got a new table which is smaller than the other one. The idea is to reduce the area of the reflecting surface in front of the loudspeakers to improve the way they sound. Acoustics is important, but making a place feel like home, that's more important. So I'm going to put my guitars where they're going to live. Right. So I've been busy. And well, welcome back. I can't wait to see what you think of this.
Thank you.
Whoa!
Well, it looks really nice.
It does, and it feels comfortable. It sounds peaceful somehow.
That's true. And I think that's the first thing to get right. So you want to be in the room. It's sort of like that grandparent house feeling, at least. In Finland, yeah. We call it like that, that it's cozy and yeah. You get this nice feeling when you walk in.
So I bet you want to see the grade report now.
For sure.
So on the left side, we've got the original report from before we started, and on the right side is a fresh one.
Okay. The traffic light table totally already looks a lot better, especially the reflections are now really nicely under control.
Yeah.
I think the most important at this point would be the reverberation. And of course, when the room was empty, it's expected or was expected that it's quite bad, and you can see it clearly. So you see on the mid-range, there's a lot of reverberation in the room. That is the first thing to get under control. Mm-hmm. Because even in the almost empty space, the high frequencies, the decay times is short, but it's all the other frequencies where you get the echo in the room.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's something that you want to level. And when doing the acoustic treatment, of course, it's easy to attenuate the high frequency decay time a lot. That's easy because they are short.
That's kind of what we see in these graphs.
Yeah, high frequency is short wavelength, so already a small like thickness of material is attenuating those frequencies. But then when you move lower in frequency, you need more material. So that's what makes the lowest frequencies most challenging. You need really a lot of absorptive material. But looking at the curves, we can see that even at the few hundred hertz, we have a drastic drop in the decay time.
And I feel quite happy with this. Now I'm quite confident that the room is pretty good for like a budget room. Mm. It's not a professional, purpose-built studio. I think it's pretty good. And I suppose now I can start playing to a degree with speaker placement.
Yeah, I think that would be a good plan to proceed. And then, of course, in the future, if you want to do some improvements on the lower frequencies, maybe you need to sacrifice one cupboard or the corner of the room for something a bit more bulky. Or if you want to experiment by making some of the wall panels thicker, you can try that as well, without really doing a new project or new building.
And so that brings my project to an end. I really hope you found it as interesting and as motivating as I have. And for more information, please see the link to genelec.com in the description below. And I'll see you in the next video.